Welcome to the Niagara Live Sessions with your host, Ken B, on BGX Radio.
Good day and welcome. Thank you for joining us on BGX Radio and another episode of Niagara Live Sessions. I'm your host, Ken B, and today we have somebody who's done pretty much everything in the music industry in the Niagara area. His name is Kevin Richard Hotte. He's both a drummer, studio musician, composer, and educator. He's the winner of Niagara Music Award, Instrument Artist of the Year in 2016, St. Catharines Arts Award nominee in the Established Artist category 2 years in a row in 2015 and 16, and Reader's Choice Award Gold Award winner for Best Local Entertainer Drummer. And in 2021, Kevin won Reader's Choice Platinum Award as the Best Local Musician. Geez, I think I need to take a deep breath after that. please welcome, folks. Please welcome the infamous and award-winning Kevin Richard Hotte.
Hello out there.
Kevin, thank you so much for joining us today.
It's my pleasure.
I had to kind of bend over backwards the past couple of weeks to get this interview going, but we're here, and I'm super happy. And we're actually doing this interview on location, and so I'm actually at his studio, and it's quite impressive, to say the least. But we have a whole bunch of questions here. We're going to listen to some music over the next hour or so, and so let's just get into it. So first of all, I know that you've been drumming for over 50 years, and now... which is a huge accomplishment in its own right. Can you please explain how you became interested in drumming and if you ever wanted to play anything other than percussion and drums?
Yeah, I to be honest with you, I never really wanted to play anything other than the drums. It wasn't until later in my music career that I discovered other instruments such as keyboard, and I dabbled with some guitar and vocals, but that's a whole other story. I never wanted to play anything other than drums. And one day my parents were backing out of the driveway. They were big music fans back then, and they would always have the car radio going when we'd go anywhere. And Build Me Up Buttercup by the Foundations came on the radio. And I just went crazy over that song. I started banging on the back of the seat, and you know, I didn't know anything about drumming at that point, but I did the best I could to try to keep a rhythm going with the song.
Right.
And then later came the Beatles, and of course, like everybody my age, the Beatles just blew up, and everybody was crazy about them, and so was I, and that started it all.
Wow. Okay. So yeah, it started, thanks to your parents, it sounds like, which is awesome. Were your parents musically inclined themselves?
My parents weren't, but my grandfather on my mother's side, he was a varied musician. He played a lot of instruments, and he had his own radio show in Niagara Falls back in the 40s. And he had toured around and played, you know, some parts of Canada with country bands and things like that. And that's basically another exposure that I got. Was he was always playing a guitar or playing a violin or fiddle, as they called it.
Right.
You know? So yeah, I've always been exposed to music.
No, that's awesome. That's awesome. I think that's a way a lot of younger musicians and aspiring musicians started off. I mean, I think a lot of it came from the parents listening to what mom and dad listened to, and even though it was kind of weird because music is always evolving, you always have your roots back kind of where your parents were, you know, when you were in your teens.
Yeah, my mother and father were like Dion and the Belmonts, the Platters, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Roy Orbison. There was no FM radio at that time. It was only AM. And so what we listened to basically was a radio station in St. Catharines called 1220 CHSC at the time. Yeah. And then in Toronto, there was a station, Chum AM was the
AM.
1050 Chum. That was the call letters.
Okay, yeah. Cool. Yeah, parents are always a big influence. At least they were also for me as I got into the entertainment industry also. But this isn't about me. So you obviously have deep knowledge of music theory. And how did you develop your music theory knowledge? And to those aspiring musicians or people that want to learn an instrument or whatever, how important is the theory and the technical side of music in order to be able to achieve what your goals are musically?
Okay, well, I mean, the answer to the first part of your question is I started learning music theory right away. As soon as I started taking formal lessons, we were learning theory at the same time, drumming theory, not music theory. I was learning to play drums, so it was all drum notation that I was learning. Right. By the age of, 9 or 10 years old, I was a fairly good sight reader. I could play and read at the same time, but you lose that over time. I mean, as I got older, got away from reading music, got involved with rock bands, didn't really use charts or sheet music in rock bands.
Right.
And now, 20, 30, 40 years later, I can still read, but I can't sight read like where I sit down with the drums and you put the music in front of me and I can just play it along with it. I have to look at it first and say, oh yeah, this is what's going on here. And then I'll play it,
Right.
As far as the other part of your question, how important is it today? It depends on the musical direction that any musician's going in. I mean, if they're doing a lot of theater-based things or studio work where they're going to have charts put in front of them, then of course, obviously they need to be able to read fairly fluently. But to be just in your basic band playing, rock covers or even your own original music, I don't think there's many that write their own charts for their own music. So I don't think it's that important to them in that respect. But definitely if someone was going to get into, like, say, a Cirque du Soleil troupe or an ensemble where they're performing, and they're going to definitely need to read because there's going to be sheet music put in front of you.
Right. No, absolutely. And to your point about, somebody wants to do it like a rock band or that kind of thing. The internet's a great thing now. It takes 2 seconds. You can go up and you can look up a guitar tab for whatever song you want or a bass tab or whatever. Yeah. And so I think in that respect, it might make people that want to get into doing a band, playing an instrument in a band, almost a little bit easier because in some ways you can skip some of the formal training and just kind of take the reins yourself and go on, do online courses and that kind of stuff.
Yeah. I mean, tabs are great for rock music. I mean, there's a little bit of confusion though, because I think some musicians confuse tabs with sheets, like the music.
Yeah, not the same.
Notation. It's two different things.
Absolutely.
Yeah. It's like when I fill in with a cover band, I create my own charts of songs that I haven't played before, aren't that familiar with. And I've come up with my own basic little language on these charts. And it's kind of a combination of like a Nashville number system and bar counting. And it's just,
right.
I know how to read it. Someone who looks at it would think it's a gibberish, but I know what's written on those, on the tablet. And I can follow it with no problem.
And that's all you need for you. I mean, you know what works best for you. So I mean, I know your talents as a drummer are not just focused on one or two genres or music styles. Tell me a little bit about which genres you're able to comfortably play and what your favorites are and why.
Okay, well, I'd like to think that I'm pretty much comfortable playing anything. I'm kind of a chameleon when it comes to that, except when it comes to opera. I mean, there's no drums in opera anyway.
Right.
Classical music. Some of the subgenres of music I'm not really crazy about. Like hip hop, I find it boring. The rhythms are just boring. And, there's acid jazz and that kind of stuff. I'm not really too familiar with a lot of that. And I wouldn't stretch myself out to want to learn to play that music because it's just not something I like myself.
Right.
I want to be able to have fun while I'm playing. And if I don't enjoy the music. Yep. What's the sense of doing it?
Absolutely.
My favorites, basically mainstream rock, jazz fusion. I like a lot of like Al Di Meola, a lot of drummers, Dave Weckl, Chris Coleman, Thomas Lang. Of course, he's from another planet when he plays. I like smooth jazz music. 90s new age music was a big influence on me, believe it or not. And prog metal and just standard progressive metal, prog and progressive rock,
It sounds like your interests are really diversified and like what I tell people myself when they say, what do I listen to? And realistically, I personally listen to everything. So what I tell people is that if it's good, it's good. It doesn't matter really what the genre is. Yeah. If it's good, it's good.
Yeah. My parents were fairly open-minded when it came to music too. So I listened to a lot of different genres then. And I think that's what's benefited me, now in my golden years. You know, it's, I go to fill in for a band and I, you know, I've heard most of the songs that they want to do before. If I haven't played them before, I've heard them before.
Right. You know. Right. Makes sense. Makes sense. Now, as a drummer myself, mm-hmm. I've noticed watching a couple of your videos. And by the way, any links or anything like to your YouTube page, all that stuff, I'm going to be putting that all on the BGX Radio Facebook page and on Twitter and on Instagram. So people can go check you out in their own time and check out what you do and maybe support your music and what you do. But all that information will be done at the time of airing. So yeah, check that out, folks. Now, because I'm also a drummer, I've noticed that you usually use a traditional grip on your drumsticks.
Right.
Okay, one over, one under, basically. Yeah. Now, what are the benefits in your eyes to a traditional grip over, let's say, like a matched grip? And because when I was learning to play drums, I learned a little bit with a traditional grip, but I realized that I couldn't get the same power and drive for rock music using that stick technique. I had to use a matched, mm-hmm. Grip. So how do you find that or how do you overcome that?
I don't really use a match grip that much. When I started playing, it was all traditional grip. If you came across a drummer who played match grip back in the 60s or even before that, it was pretty much a sign that they were not formally trained in drumming.
Right.
And for me, it's just something I started at the beginning and it's carried through my life. And, you know, when I saw that Neil Peart used traditional grip a lot and I knew that I was on the right course and, you know, he switched occasionally to match grip, but primarily he used traditional grip and I didn't see the need to change. I can use match grip and once in a while I might, if my hand is sore, if I've been playing a lot of dates, I'll switch to the match grip just to give my hand a rest. But it's something I started with and it's never really changed for me. It's about technique, you know. It's like golfing, you know, they tell you when you're going to tee off, most people they want the tendency to kill the ball when they hit it. They want to hit it really hard so it can go really far. And in actual fact, you're using the club, the pendulum effect of the club and the technique in your wrists and everything to drive the ball. And it's the same with drumming. With the traditional grip, it's all in the wrist action, you know, and breathing. Of course, it took me a long time to learn about breathing and
about breath control,
how it affected your playing and even your meter. If you didn't breathe properly, your meter would get affected. Finger control, you know, doing the finger thing with the back of the stick, you know,
so that's your ghost notes and that kind of stuff. Yeah.
It's all technique. I don't think the grip really, if someone wants to use match grip, so be it. I don't.
So it's basically whatever works for you. Okay, cool. So, hey, let's play some music. This first song is from the Canadian progressive band Saga. Hailing obviously from Oakville, Ontario. Tell me a little bit why this band and this song in particular means something to you.
Well, back in the day, before Saga was called Saga, they were known as a band called Pockets. And I saw them play at a local club here on St. Paul Street called the Montebello Inn, and they played there as Pockets. And then I kept up with the band and I knew they changed their name to Saga. And then when their first album came out, I ran out right away and picked it up because I like the fact that they're local, basically Oakville, Niagara. Right. They're a Canadian band. I'm very much a patriot, so I support Canadian music. And I like the drumming of Steve Negus. I mean, he was no Neil Peart, but he had some interesting things. And he also was one of the first drummers that I saw use the basic electronic drums in that little the little suitcase thing that the lead singer would put together. He'd come out and do a thing with the suitcase that he would open up, and it had electronic pads in it. You didn't see them, but he would do this percussion thing with Steve. And I just found it very interesting. And then I liked the album. The whole first album was really a favorite of mine.
Perfect. Great answer. So let's do this. From the 1978 self-titled debut studio album, this is Saga and Perfectionist on BGX Radio. Thank you.
just right. If things were not planned and all done by hand, he would ready himself for a fight. One afternoon, while sitting alone, he came to a great realization. When it's his turn to die, will it be enough time?
From the 1978 self-titled debut studio album, this was Saga and Perfectionist on BGX Radio. Thank you all very much for sticking around and listening in today. We are here with Kevin Hotte, musician, director, educator, He does pretty much everything, and we're just having a great old time having a chat with him today. So, Kevin, tell me a bit about your journey from musician to producing your own independent albums, and what were your biggest obstacles, and how were they overcome?
Okay, well, my journey started basically when I discovered that I could write music, for one thing. I mean, I'd experienced a couple of personal tragedies in my life, and there was a lot of emotion tied to those, and I wanted to express it. Being a musician, I wanted to express my feelings, and I decided to sit down at a keyboard and plunk away until I could put something out that would help me express those feelings. And that's when I realized that I had a knack for putting melodies together. And of course, being a drummer, I could tie the melodies to the rhythms. And discovering that I could write was part of the journey, the biggest part of the journey. As far as what I write, even now today, I don't really have control of what comes out of me.
Right.
It's like I'll sit down and say, I'd like to write this kind of a song with this kind of a motif. And it starts out one way, but by the time I'm done through the process, sometimes it comes out like I've heard it in my head before. Other times it comes out totally different. And, you know, and that's great. That's the element of creativity. That's where creativity comes from. And each one of those songs that you write, that's a child that you bring into the world, you know?
Absolutely.
The next was, the costs for traditional recording were at the time very high.
I mean,
the studio time was anywhere from $75 to $150 to $200 an hour for, you know, even your B studios, you know, not your A studios. So it was prohibitive. But then news came out about, home studio recording, and technology had changed, and there was home-based recording coming to the forefront. And I delved deeply into that. And I first started learning about MIDI and MIDI keyboards, and then sequencers, and then digital audio workstations. And, you know, actually before digital audio workstations, you could take the MIDI and through ADAT and everything, tie it all together to an analog board. And then came digital audio workstations, where it was completely done, you know, through computer or in the box, as they say, which is basically the way I write and compose now, is in the box. You know, I had the big mixing console and everything, and just for convenience and everything else, and to stay up with the technology, it's gone. You know, so now I just have a digital audio workstation and a controller, and that's pretty much it.
Right. No, that's awesome. It has really made it easier for people that want to do their own recording and stuff. It's so easy now, just because, like you said, you got to put out a little bit on some hardware, but I mean, most of it is software based and everything now. So, yeah. Having good computer knowledge, whether you're using Intel based or Apple based, kind of important if you want to get into it yourself.
Yeah, the trick too is also realizing that, I mean, there's so many marketing ploys out there for the hardware part of it, and a lot of times the hardware part of it isn't really affecting the sound. It's just doing a function, and some people forget that, and they'll pay top dollar for something that's not really changing the sound of their music at all.
Right.
You know, and so you just have to be a smart shopper and be aware. A lot of people just buy brand names because it's a brand name and they figure it's good gear and I had to pay a lot for it. And there's a pride thing there. But for me, I'm more frugal. If it'll do the job, the same job that a high end piece of gear will do, and it's not affecting the sound and it performs well, I'll go with that.
Yeah. I see a lot of people buying stuff that's, you know what they're buying it for, and you're like, geez, that's way more than you need, you know, that kind of thing. So it, to them, it's probably a little bit of flex, you know.
Yeah, they just want bragging rights. Like that,
you know,
exactly.
So you've recorded, directed, and produced three independent albums, namely your first album, A Different Drum, followed by Inventing Fire, and finally Illumination, which is being touted as a rock soundtrack at its best. I want to know a little bit about that, but first, tell us a little bit about these very diverse and eclectic albums and how they differ from each other.
Okay, well, A Different Drum was my first studio album, more or less. It was inspired very much by the new age music of the 90s. I like that whole clean, holistic approach to music. They had elements of jazz in it. There was elements of pop. And I just like the style and some of the concepts of the music itself really spoke to me. And I wanted to write and record music that, like that, some drummers, most drummers at the time, would shy away from. They would think it's wimpy kind of music or not really mainstream. And I liked the idea of going left instead of right.
Sure.
It was a learning experience for me, the first album. It got me introduced to the technology end of things and the business end of things. Through that, I started my record label, Da Vinci's Notebook Records, and we had retail distribution and everything. And it actually originally came out on cassette, and then I transferred it over to CD when CDs were
right.
And then came along and Inventing Fire, my second album, and the concept behind that was basically I was sitting one day realizing that, you know, when it comes to music, there's no such thing as original anymore. Like everything's been done, and so it's like inventing fire. How can you invent fire when it already existed? A further expansion on a different drum. That's basically what it was. It again blended new age with rock music. And I did some techniques like I doubled timpani with some of the bass lines in it to give it more of a bottom, beefier end, and utilized multiple rhythms that intertwine with melodies. So sometimes I'd have a melody going one way and the rhythm going the other way, and they worked, for me anyway. Didn't get a lot of commercial success. Most people, when they listen to my original music, I don't think they get it, because they don't realize that I'm not trying to write for the mainstream. I'm writing for film, television, and gaming and multimedia use.
Right.
And I'm not trying to write hit commercial songs. The third album, Illumination, was inspired by my feeling of being illuminated by the technology of recording. And I've felt like I was becoming more savvy from a business end of things as well.
Right.
And then of course the internet was coming along too, and social media was big, mm-hmm. And it also contained for the first time two vocal tracks, that album, which were Touched and Pagan Nation. And so that was the first time that Pagan Nation is actually me singing, and Touched, I had a friend do the vocal on that one. Okay. So yeah, that's where those three came from.
Well, okay, so the quote, rock soundtrack at its finest. Tell me about that.
That surprised me as well. There was a magazine in town here called Pulse Magazine. Yep. It was an entertainment paper, and the reviewer there, that's basically what he called it, and it threw me for a loop, because I liked my music. I mean, you have to like your own music. I certainly didn't think of it like that, and she apparently did.
Wow. That's a good story. Yeah, I remember Pulse. They haven't been around in a while, but I actually look for it. I used to actually go out and look for it, because it had all, what was happening at all the clubs. Yeah. And
Our former mayor, Walter Senzik, was at one time the editor of...
Oh, was he really?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Shout out to Mayor Senzik. Yay. Okay, so let's actually have a listen to one of your songs right now. Okay. Please give us a little bit of a glimpse into the making of this song. And would you kindly introduce it for our listeners? You know which
yes,
one it is.
Yes. Right?
Perfect.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Well, I wanted this song to be more raw and high energy. A rock with some flashy drumming. Everybody likes the quads. When a drummer plays quads, everybody likes the way that sounds. Neil was famous for his quads. I think he inspired a lot of drummers to do the quads. And this song won me the 2016 Niagara Music Award. So this is for Instrumental Artist of the Year. And it's one I'm proud of. I've got a video on YouTube with the song. So it's called Threshold.
All right, from the Illumination album, that was Threshold by Kevin Hotte, who is still sitting in front of me. Yay! Hey. And so, yeah, we're back. So when you're planning, writing, and composing new music, where do you gain a lot of your inspiration? And kindly give us a glimpse into like your thought process when it comes to building and compiling your albums.
Well, the first part of the process is I'm very visual based. I had my own photography business for a number of years as a pro photographer, doing film and video and still photography. So a lot of times I'll get a visualization of a scene or an event, and it'll just give me a feeling. And I'll start plunking around on the keyboard or on my drums, and I'll come up with a theme and just let it grow from there. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it starts with a drum or a rhythm part. Other times it'll start with a single melody on the keyboard. It's largely centered around experimentation. And like I said earlier, I really don't have any control over what the end result comes out like. I mean, I know what I want to write, but the way things go, it takes a life of its own, and it just goes from there.
Absolutely. And that's the creative process, I think, for a lot of people. Like I had just mentioned a band to you here when we were playing the last song, a band that I like, Unleash the Archers. Their writing and composing and everything is very much like yours, like your vision, the way you go about it. Where everything lands is where it lands,
yeah. Kind of. The secret is knowing when to stop. I mean, when you've got like I have unlimited access to gear, I don't have to worry about studio time. It's just my own time. And knowing that you're never going to be perfect. You can strive for perfection,
right?
But knowing you're never going to get perfection because of one reason or another, and knowing when to stop and say, okay, that's, I hate to use this term, good enough, but that's good. Otherwise you'll be going on forever. It's like young bands when they're rehearsing in the basement, they don't want to go out and play till they're ready, but yet they never think they're going to be ready. So they never get out and play. Yeah. Yeah. So it's sooner or later, you got to cut the umbilical cord and say, okay, go fly off, my child, go into the world. There you go.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Time to spread your wings. Yeah. Now I know you're also a session musician, mm-hmm. and also play with various other original as well as cover bands in Southern Ontario. Yeah. What challenges are you faced with when playing with other bands in respect to style, genre, music repertoire, tour schedule, etc.? I mean, it seems like you'd have to be almost superhuman to tackle this kind of workload, not to mention writing, directing your own music, maintaining a thriving Facebook page, which we will be talking about next. I mean, you're wearing a cape and tights under your clothes. I'm just wondering.
Well, it's good scheduling and organizational habits, I think, are what are important. You know, you keep a good calendar, schedule things properly, and have a good support system. Like my wife, Natalie, and I work like a team. She's got her own day job and things going on, but she bends over backwards to help me get the things I need. And one of the biggest difficulties for me since about 1997 was when I was diagnosed. I'm a type 2 diabetic.
Okay.
And being a diabetic, and of course, playing on the road or playing out with a hectic schedule, you know, you get to sound checks, you don't get to eat at proper times. And sometimes the food that you do get to eat is junk food, you know, yeah. Deep fried. And that, so that's been a struggle for me. That's, if I had to say any struggle, that's been the main struggle, that's been the diabetic, getting that under control and maintaining a good numbers for my glucose levels and everything, and right. Fitting it all in and still being able to perform. And some might know that John Rutsey, the original drummer for Rush, I mean, that's one of the factors that got him out of Rush, was because he was a diabetic, and he didn't take care of himself, and basically caught up with him. So that's a struggle, is being type 2 diabetic and knowing when to take my insulin, when to take my meds, and knowing when to eat and how much to eat, and right. Balance that out with my injections and everything when you're on a hectic schedule, you know.
So basically you have to know to take care of yourself so you can take care of the others that you're working with.
Exactly. And you know, to sort of tie a bow on your question, it's I can't stress enough the scheduling aspect of it and having someone to help you. You know, if you don't write things down, if you don't put them in your phone calendar, you're going to forget about them. You know, you can say you'll do it later, but my advice would be when you get a booking or when you get an appointment, put it down now. Don't say you'll do it later because you're going to forget.
You'll always forget. Absolutely. Sounds like my life story. Yeah. So tell us a little bit about Niagara Drummers Collective and who it's for and what's the goal of the group.
Niagara Drummers Collective is a group I started on Facebook, I guess back around 2015, something like that. And it's a labor of love for me, basically. I decided I wanted to get as many drummers, primarily local, but not just in St. Catharines, Niagara, but also the Toronto, Hamilton, GTA, Buffalo areas, and just get in contact with them, get them to sign up so that we could have some kind of fellowship, promote fellowship among ourselves and support each other. I mean, back in the day, my environment sometimes was very competitive. You'd be playing a show and there would be other drummers in the audience and they would stand back with their arms folded and not have anything good to say. And just all you could tell, all they were thinking about was how much better they could do it than you, or, you know, and I didn't want that. I'm not really competitive when it comes to the musician type, you know, area of things. I'd rather support musicians and fellow drummers. And exchange ideas and techniques and educate each other, buy and sell gear. And that's what Niagara Drummers Collective is all about, is fellowship between drummers. We have some pretty big name drummers in there too, like Larnell Lewis was a member. Mark Kelso was a member at one time. So we've got some named drummers that, you know, they don't participate. They sort of lurk in the background, but they're watching what's going on. And that's basically what Niagara Drummers Collective is.
So basically it's a Facebook group. If you go to Facebook, and search out, Niagara Drummers Collective, you will see it there, and it's open to basically drummers of all experience levels, including hand drumming, that kind of perfect. So all the drummers out there, go check it out.
Hit me up and I'll sign you up. As long
awesome.
As you're a drummer, you're in.
All right. Let's listen to another one of your songs, in particular track 6 from your latest album. It's called Home Game 2. Tell us a little bit about this.
There's a bit of a backstory on this song. First of all, on my first album, I had a song called Home Game. And Home Game 2 on this album is a derivative of Home Game. I wanted to expand on it. I expanded on it because the CBC network at one time had a contest on to write a new theme for Hockey Night in Canada. And they took submissions by musicians all across, I don't know if it was across Canada or Ontario. And so I basically took it upon myself to rewrite my original song, Home Game, with a little different spin and called it Home Game 2. And that made it onto my album, Illumination. There's nothing better, because I'm a proud Canadian as well, there's nothing better than a hockey game on a Saturday night, you know.
Absolutely.
And I've been to a number of Leaf games, and there's nothing better than being at the arena on a Saturday night, you know, to catch the energy of the game, you know. And I'm a big Leaf fan, and it's like I said, it's a derivative or a continuation of the original song Home Game from my first album.
Okay. Yeah. I'm curious, because you said you entered it into the song contest. What was the response to it? Did you get any response at all?
A few people liked it, but generally overall, there were so many.
It's hard to pick.
Yeah, it was hard to pick. And I didn't win, of course. Somebody else did, you know. But what are you going to do?
Absolutely. Okay, well, let's take a listen to it. Once again, folks, this is Kevin Richard Hotte, and this is Home Game 2 on BGX Radio. Okay, so the past few years has been really, really difficult on almost everybody. So, sure. Especially dealing with COVID, and it's been pretty rough on many industries. But few industries, I think, were impacted more than the entertainment industry, in particular to the indie music scene. How were you able to survive that almost unsurmountable obstacle called the pandemic? And how did you use that time to your advantage?
Yeah, well, I mean, before COVID hit, the 3-4 years before, I was I had a couple main bands that I was drumming in, and then I was getting a lot of calls to do fill-in sub work. So I was playing 100 plus shows a year, which is crazy, and my schedule was crazy. And then COVID came along, and everything went suddenly dry. I knew I would have to find a way to keep myself, to promote myself as a drummer and as a musician, to keep top of mind with the public. So obviously I turned to the internet like everyone did, you know. In 2020, I started a video series called Fun with Wood, and where I would just take cover songs and drum along with them and just put them out there on YouTube or promoted them through my social media. I did a couple of drum along videos with some name artists, jazz artists by the name of Kinga Glick. She's a Polish bass player, phenomenal bass player. I've done two videos with her. And then there was a cellist / bass player from Austria. Her name is Julia Hofer or Hofer. I'm not sure how she pronounces it. Okay. That's basically what I did. I resorted to the internet and just tried to be as active as I could, you know, with videos. And of course it also gave me a lot of time to spend down here in my studio, getting more familiar with my gear. I mean, you're always a student, never a master when it comes to this
or
anything creative for that matter. So that's basically what I did.
Okay. So you took advantage of it and, especially for people that were used to playing live, like in the bars and clubs like that, I think it really hurt them, a lot of them. But you had other creative outlets that you can do in solitude, like at your studio and stuff like that. It sounds like you fared pretty well overall.
Yeah. I started to get more interested too. I decided to try to embark on a voiceover effort, which hasn't really paid off yet, but I started learning about voiceovers, doing voiceovers, and put up a website for my voiceover work. And you just have to.
We'll once again, I'll put a link to that also, so people can check that out also. Now let's talk a little bit, and touchy subject, I think, to some people, but I think we're both mature enough to have a little chat about this. So let's talk a little bit about the Canadian music scene, and particularly unsigned indie artists. One of the biggest complaints or criticisms I tend to hear from Canadian indie acts is how difficult or almost impossible it is to get any notoriety, PR, let alone any airplay on terrestrial radio in Canada or the US. What's your opinion on the state of independent music in Canada, and how might it be improved in the future?
Well, I mean, that, like we were saying, that's a loaded question, and you'll get a different answer probably from every musician you talk to. Everybody has their own viewpoint on it. For me, I think it's kind of bleak. I hate to say it. Streaming is taking advantage of, I mean, some might say in stronger terms, raping the artists by paying fractions of a penny per stream. It's happened to me myself. I've had multiple streams, many streams, and not made much at all off Spotify in particular. But again, I have to put a disclaimer out there. This is all, what I'm about to say is in my humble opinion. Right. So
it's not necessarily indicative of everybody's mindset. Yeah,
exactly. Yeah. Exactly. But this has been my experience. The only way to make money, in my opinion, is still to perform live and sell your product from the stage, whether it's CDs, USB drives,
merch.
That's still merch. That's still the old school way is still the best way to do it. You know, perform live and sell your stuff from the stage. Or if you can afford it, and of course many of us can't, pay someone to hype and promote your work. And I think that's one of the downfalls, is that now everything's, you got to pay for everything, and people are really taking advantage of musicians when they know most musicians are lower paid. They don't have the money to put into this kind of thing, but they prey on their ego. they prey on their vanity. You know, we're going to help you get airplay. We're going to help you get streams, but you got to pay us this much. And, I hope a lot of musicians are wise to that and they're not falling prey to it and getting into huge amounts of debt.
No, absolutely. It's really tough, especially, you know, like I say, in the indie scene, that's what I've heard. I don't make music anymore, but I do talk to a lot of bands and a lot of artists and stuff like that. And they say a lot the same thing.
The other big change has been that the venues themselves, back in the day, you know, the venue promoted the band that's going to be playing there. Nowadays, the venue expects the band to bring their draw,
their
crowd. Mm-hmm. And they don't even, so I've played some clubs where they don't even put it on social media that we're going to be there. And then they say to us, well, where's all the people? Well, did you promote us? You know, we can do only so much, you know, and the pay rates have stagnated. They've remained the same for the last 20 years. Bands aren't making, there's been no increase despite our costs are going up, you know, and there's been no change in that. And the venues are always crying poor. And then after COVID, it was the same thing. Oh, we got hit hard by COVID. Well, so did we as musicians. We didn't work at all.
And yeah. And unlike, let's say a place like Hooters as an example, that's a nationwide chain, and I believe they have additional benefits. So even during COVID, that they may not have been working as much and may have been closed more, but they had other benefits from the company. Yeah. The small mom and pop bars and clubs and stuff that are supporting these local bands, they don't have that financial cushion to be able to do huge amounts of promotion, but I completely get your point. Yeah. You know, if people don't know that you're playing somewhere, yeah, how the hell are you going to get people in there? I mean, because at the end of the night, you know, you had a successful night, not necessarily if you had people on the dance floor, but how the ring off at the end of the night at the bar was. Yeah, so if people aren't there and if they're not buying drinks and they're not buying food and stuff like that, it doesn't, you know, it's not going to work for the bar. So the bars, I think, and the venues, you're absolutely right. I think they need to be a little bit more involved in you know, they're not just promoting the band, but they're also promoting their own brand.
Yeah. I mean, there was a lot of funny things that went on through all COVID. I mean, I know of bars and restaurants, restaurants that had bands come in and play where they all of a sudden realized and discovered they had a really big takeout business and they never went back to having bands after that. And there was, you know, they had problems with staffing. And then once COVID hit, the takeout business took over. And so it was a lot of different changes.
DoorDash, get the dishes, yeah, that kind of stuff. Yeah. Yeah. No, absolutely. Now, in respect to, and I think most people, especially people that are listen to a lot of rock, heavy metal, that kind of thing, in respect to the de-evolution of popular music quality, some might argue that today's pop music is simply awful and is hugely repetitious compared to, let's say, music of the 60s or 70s or even the 80s and 90s. What do you think are some of the reasons for the quality de-escalation for modern music and why it's taken such a hit?
I mean, I kind of agree and yet disagree with that. I mean, this is all in my humble opinion, of course.
Sure.
When you look at music like in the 90s, there was kind of an anti-musician movement. Bands like, I'm going to take heat for this, but Nirvana. I mean, Kurt Cobain was not a great guitar player.
Right.
You know, Dave Grohl was a good drummer, but Kurt Cobain really didn't play lead guitar. He basically played chords. And I think bands kind of took a pride in the fact, like in punk in the 70s, they couldn't play their instruments. They just made a lot of noise and they did things that people liked on stage. And so they became popular. So I think that's one thing. And in the 90s, there was another anti-musician movement like that. And it resulted in a lot of poor quality musicianship being recorded,
like grunge, basically.
Yeah, grunge. Yeah. Yeah. And then other artists that were sampling already established songs, and I hate to say it, but that points to the early hip hop era and rap, that kind of thing. And music today, it's all become about optics and image, and, you know, that's just not, they're forgetting the substance, the intrinsic part of the music, which is the creation, the creativity. And that's basically how I feel about it. I mean, there's nothing really more to say.
Even the quality of the songs themselves, I mean, getting away from, let's say, lyrical content or that kind of thing, even the songs themselves, you go back to the, you know, 50s, 60s, 70s, even the early 80s, music back then, even if it was pop, was very dynamic. Yeah. And I think one of the things with all music, almost all music today that you get is heavily, heavily compressed. Oh, yeah. And as you know, when you compress an audio signal, you pretty much strip it of dynamics. So yeah. So now you got songs that are less dynamic. They're a lot louder because, hey, whoever has the loudest song is going to be heard. Yeah. I think a lot of the mixing techniques and stuff like that are also taken away from the quality of the music.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Except I think there's certain country artists that do it good, you know, and I think even some pop artists like Lady Gaga.
Oh, she's amazing. I love her.
Yeah. And she writes her own music, and that's a big thing. Same with Taylor Swift. I mean, when she first came out, her vocals were very, very sketchy. She was very pitchy, but she dug in, she took lessons, and she again writes her own music. She might have a little help, but yeah. And the big knock for me with today's music is it's so producer centric. I mean, you get an artist that's got decent talent, but this producer comes in and either it's because the label wants him to mentor them or the producer himself wants to put his thumbprint on the music, you know, whatever. Absolutely. The reason, it's just become so reliant on the producers rather than the actual creators.
I had read an article one time, and I don't know, maybe you heard it. It was the article was twofold. One of them was about music writers.
Right.
And the other one was about producers. Mm-hmm. And apparently something like 60% of all top 50 hits over the past 5 or 6 years were written by one of 8 different people. Right. And that those albums were produced by one of under a dozen producers.
Producers, yeah.
So you wonder why all these artists, especially these pop and hip hop artists, they all sound exactly the same. It's because it's all the brainchild of just a handful of people.
Yeah, exactly.
You know?
Yeah. What group was it? You look at a producer, you know, someone like David Foster.
Right.
He's got his own solo career, but he's helped a lot of other artists. But the artist still sounds like the artist. You take who was it? Mutt Lange. How would Shania Twain have sounded if it wasn't for Mutt Lange? And how much influence did Mutt Lange have on her sound? You know, sure, certain things like the drum sound and some of the production techniques, yeah, that's all him. But the actual writing, you know, did he have an effect on it? Bob Rock, if you watch that documentary with Metallica, Some Kind of Animal,
okay.
The camera follows him in the studio, and you can see how he sways the band and how he influences the band and at some time referees the band, you know. But I just think that personally producers have too much to say about their music. Let the artist be the artist and let their talent come through, and don't put your thumbprint on it because you feel the need to, or because you think you're better than them. They're the ones that came up with the brainchild in the first place.
Yeah, the producers are there as a tool, yeah, to enhance, not alter.
That's right.
I agree with you. 100%. Now, not all music today has been taken a downward spiral. Some bands like our next song that we're about to do seems to be doing things right. So tell us a little bit about Dirty Honey and what drew you to that band?
They have an old school sound, but yet they sound so fresh at the same time. They have a lot of rock feel, and they really rock out 80s style. But like I said, it still sounds fresh for that. It's kind of like Greta Van Fleet in a way, you know, like,
okay. Yeah.
But
it's a name I haven't heard in a while.
Yeah. Dirty Honey is a newer band. I don't know how new, but they have a fresh sound for having an old school attitude.
Okay. Well, why don't we take a listen then? This is Dirty Honey and California Dreamin'.
We'll be right back.
Dirty Honey. Great band. I'll have to check these guys out more. I really like their style. And you're right. Very classic 80s, 90s rock feel, just really driving beat and everything. Yep. So you and your wife, Natalie, right?
Right.
You created an organization called the AICRA. What's that about? And how can folks get in touch with you to get more information?
All right. Well, it's an acronym, ACRA, and it stands for the Alliance of Independent Canadian Recording Artists. And the backstory on ACRA is that we, my wife and I wanted to do some kind of performance event. And we met up with some people who owned an art gallery in Niagara Falls. And I was playing there every Saturday, playing a jazz gig with another player. And they said, you know, if you ever want to do anything else, you can use our stage. And they had a PA and lights and everything. And we came up with this idea for ACRA to put on a concert series for unsigned indie recording acts in Canada, if they wanted to come from wherever. We wanted to apply for funding from the government and organizations like Factor, and get funded to put this concert series on. So we filled out all the applications, and of course we got turned down. And by that time we had already reached out to a number of artists, and we said to them, you know, this is what's happening. We tried to get funding. We're not going to be able to pay you, but we will provide food and beverages and everything. And if you still want to do it for exposure, I hate using that term, but if you still want to do it, you're more than willing to come down and play your set, and you'll eat good and drink good anyway, you know. And we weren't expecting many of them to really want to do it, because some were coming from Toronto, Brantford, Hamilton, all over the place. And actually, they all agreed to. They said, yeah, we still think it's a great idea.
That's awesome.
So we put on a concert series that ran about 6 months. We had every weekend of the 6 months, we had a show on a Saturday afternoon at this art gallery. And I'd like to think it was successful, but we paid for all the food and drink out of our own pocket, and all the promotion, radio interviews that I did to promote it. And so we wound up spending just under $10,000 out of our pocket on it. And we're happy that we did it. We're proud that we did it. It didn't happen the way we wanted it to, but nonetheless, it happened. And we hopefully helped some unknown artists get a little bit of exposure.
So that was that's a one-time organization. Does it exist even now?
I should also say that the name of the concert series was Indie Gives Rise. That's what we called it.
Okay.
And right now the organization is dormant. It's not closed by any means. If an opportunity comes up to do something else, maybe with a partner in the future, we would be more than willing to entertain, you know, the aspect of doing something, you know.
Perfect. So if there's any musicians or event and event promoters, that kind of stuff, that are interested, get in touch with Kevin, and you never know, you could be the catalyst for something wonderful.
Absolutely.
So
yep.
There you go. For sure. So tell us a bit about your drumming workshops and how people can get involved.
Okay. Well, my drumming workshop is called Circular Motion. And that's just a name I gave to it. You know, circular, of course, signifying the drum, and motion, of course, the motion of drumming. It's kind of a quasi holistic approach to hand drumming, primarily hand drumming. I do have a section in it where I start on a real drum kit and I play a bit of a drum solo, and then I come out and I talk to the audience. It deals with human relations to the world around us, the sounds around us, you know, how the rhythm of an air conditioner can be duplicated on a drum,
right.
You know,
right.
How you can hear a babbling brook and the rhythm in that brook, you can translate that to the drum. And I've used it for relating sounds in our environment, our everyday environment and our natural environment. I did a drum circle for the Pan Am Games when they were here in the summer, I think it was 2018.
Yeah, that's cool. Yeah,
they asked me to do a drum circle at Lakeside. Was it Lakeside Park? Yeah, Lakeside Park. I did it. Every year I do the summer solstice drumming down the sun in Niagara on the Lake to celebrate summer solstice. And I've done workshops for the MS Society and that basically drum circle things. And that's pretty much what it is. I've also been wanting to do it for team building and bonding, corporate events, you know. And just if people want to have a backyard barbecue and they want to do a drum circle, they can hire me to come out and lead a drum circle.
That sounds awesome. Yeah, no, that's
kind of like a Tupperware party, but with a djembe.
No. Hey, you know, if that's what you're into, I mean, who's to say anything about that? No. I'm odd and different is always good. Original is always good, in my opinion. So, yeah. So as many people know, you're also the main drummer for an extremely popular cover band from Niagara here called Rock of 80s. Right. Tell us a bit about the band and your experience with them, and how you got started with Ian and Terry.
Yeah, like we were talking off air, I started with them about, 2 years before COVID or so. And I started as their sub drummer when their regular drummer couldn't make it. And of course, the events led to the point where, you know, he couldn't make it more frequently than he could. And so I became their main drummer. And then COVID hit, of course. But I joined them full time the year before COVID hit. And they're great guys, lots of fun, extremely talented,
yes.
and very business savvy when it comes to the local music scene and what to play, what not to play, who to talk to and who not to talk to. But we have lots of fun. They're a couple of characters.
Do you have a problem giving our listeners a little bit of a hint on where you guys are going to be playing, let's say, in the next month and a half or so?
Yeah, we are playing this Friday night. That's going to be December. I can't remember the date, but we're playing at Chip and Charlie's in Niagara Falls. Okay. We're playing New Year's Eve at the Cat's Caboose in St. Catharines, Ontario. And we're also playing at a club called the Lucky Penny in Meriton. And then we're going to be back at the Powerhouse in Stony Creek in January. So we're all over the place. Southern.
People can get your performance dates from your Facebook page,
From the Rock of 80s, Rock of 80s Band Facebook page.
Okay, yeah. And once again, I'm going to have all the links to all of these things. So people, one way or another, they're going to find you and know where you guys are. Yeah. So our next song is called Little Grays. It's another great tune you released on your last album. Parts of it have a very much of a 2112 Rush feel. Was this intentional or was this coincidental?
I say coincidental, but maybe subliminal too, because of my influence of Rush and my love for Rush. But I didn't sit down and say, I want to write something like 2112. It's inspired by a Close Encounter of the Third Kind, inspired by a movie called Fire in the Sky. So the story of Travis Walton, who claims he was abducted I think it was Arizona.
Yes.
And
yeah.
He spent 5 days or something on.
I'm pretty sure I've seen that. Yeah.
And that's basically where the idea for the movie came from.
Oh, wow.
It was Fire in the Sky, and it's inspired by Close Encounter.
Yeah, I had a suspicion when I saw the name Little Grays that it had to do with aliens, and guess what? I was right. So,
I'm one of those.
So let's check this out. This is Kevin Hotte.
Okay, and, before we do that, we have to put tinfoil hats on.
exactly. You're not a flat earther. Okay, no, just joking. So once again, this is Kevin Hotte and Little Grays on Niagara Live Sessions on BGX Radio.
Thank you.
Are back once again. Boy, I can't believe it. It's been darn near an hour and a half that we've been chatting here. It seems like it's only been 10 minutes. So anyway, as many of you listening may have noticed, I haven't asked Kevin at all about his musical influences growing up or who influences him musically today. I did this kind of on purpose because I want BGX radio listeners to learn about your experience, your influence in the drumming, performing, recording, teaching community and production community before we learned about your music idols and mentors over the years. Plus the choice of songs you made, I think after listening to your choice of songs, I think most people would be able to find parallels between what you like and what you wanted to play and what your influences are. So this is now an opportunity to see how close we actually are to that truth. So who inspired you growing up and who continues to inspire you today?
Growing up, it was Motown and the Beatles. And from there, it got into Rush, of course. Neil was from this area, so I fell in love with Neil and his drumming. And other drummers, Chris Coleman is another one of my very favorite drummers today. Dave Weckl, of course. Mike Oldfield, Tubular Bells, that was another influence of mine. David Arkenstone, he's a new age artist. He had a lot of influence in my writing style. As the aforementioned Dream Theater, there are some more. Steve Vai, I like Steve Vai.
Amazing.
Yeah, guitarist. So my influences, I could have listed a number of different songs for you to play. There's so many. I've got a wide variety of listening preferences, everything from traditional jazz to country to new age to prog rock to math rock. You know, it's a a couple of other bands I can mention that they're not really influences, but I really like them. There's a band called Polyphia. It's kind of similar to Arch Echo. They got a guitar player there by the name of Tim Henson. He's just unbelievable. If you get a chance, listen to them as well. Absolutely. So that's pretty much my influences.
Okay. Now, I know you got another album possibly in the works right now. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, I'm currently working on my fourth album. It's titled Random Acts of Music. I've almost got the artwork all finalized. I have the cover done. I'm just working on credits and things like that. It's going to be a mixture of different styles of music, and that's hence the title Random Acts of Music. And also a playoff of Random Acts of Kindness, you know, just,
okay.
So yeah, that's what I'm working on now. It's going to have everything from jazz to some straight up rock stuff on it, and another vocal tune. There's a song I'm working on right now that's about a desert storm and problems in the Middle East, you know, and it's called Ancient Sands.
So it sounds like it's a really reflective album, somewhat political.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm thinking it's going to be my last full-length album that I release, because the trend today seems to be going to more releasing singles, yeah. And it's faster. You can get them out faster. You write one song, put it out on a single, and boom, you don't have to wait for all 10, 12, 15 tracks to be written before you release something. And I think that's the way I want to go. I might try releasing some stuff on flash drives instead of CDs.
Oh, cool.
You know,
okay.
Of course, streaming is still the main way to go.
It's even easiest. Streaming is the devil,
but
it's tough to get music out there. I mean, do you have a timeline, by the way, for this album?
No, it's all as time allows. I mean, I've been working on it for a good couple of years now, and I'm busy with my other gigs, with Rock of 80s and with other stuff that's going on. I'm fitting it in when I can, but I'm hoping to get it finished by the end of the next year.
Oh, like perfect.
End of 2024.
Well, we'll have to keep an eye open for it. And when it is released, let BGX Radio know, and I'll see about getting a song or two in our rotation, or at least on one of our indie shows. So that would be awesome. Yeah. So between playing with different local bands, studio work, mentoring other drummers of all shapes and sizes, and producing your own material, which one of those things gives you kind of the most enjoyment?
Hands down, writing and recording my own material, because it's 100% my creation. It's me, and it's basically me intrinsically, you know.
Right.
I write for myself and not to impress anyone. I don't have to worry about impressing anyone, and it'll be my legacy long after I'm gone. It's gonna live on, and I think all of us want to leave a good legacy behind. And I'm proud of the work I've done, even though it's been flawed sometimes in production and things like that, but I'm still nonetheless proud of the writing and the creative ideas.
Yeah, if you've got it, do it. And you know something, there's always, with independent music, there's always an audience.
Oh, yeah.
So getting your music out there and stuff, I don't think is as difficult as it sometimes is. I mean, you may not get airplay on terrestrial radio and stuff like that, but I'm seeing personally myself also a trend where people are starting to get away from terrestrial radio, unless you're like between 18 and 25. Yeah. But people are starting to go underground. They're starting to realize that a lot of the best talents and bands that are out there are independent albums, and you'll never, ever hear them on the radio.
I mean, to get on terrestrial radio, you have to be connected. That's the bottom line. You have to,
and that cost.
Yeah, the cost.
That costs
you
money.
Have to have money, and you have to be connected.
All right. No, absolutely. So this next song Kevin chose is from a band, once again, I personally never heard before you sent me the music list. Name of the band is Arch Echo. At least to me, it has a very, very strong progressive rock feel of like Arjun Lucassen, which was formerly of the band Arion, and now with Star One. So let's check them out. This is Arch Echo and Color Wheel on BGX Radio. We'll be right back. we're back again. That was Arch Echo on BGX Radio. So we're moving right along. This is, I believe this is our final final set of questions here. So we're almost to the end, believe it or not. So we pretty much come to the end of our interview, but before we sign off, I'd like to ask you what we call some lightning round questions, okay, or quick fire questions. Okay. And they are intended just to inject a little bit of fun and possibly a laugh or two into the interview. Each of these eight questions should be able to be answered in about 15 seconds or less. So are you ready?
I'm ready.
Okay, let's do this. Question number one, what's your favorite social media platform?
YouTube.
Okay. What's a skill that you don't have but you'd love to learn, musically or otherwise?
I'd love to be a chef.
Oh, yeah. Cooking. Okay. Yeah. I wouldn't have seen you as that, but that's awesome. That's awesome. What's the best piece of advice that you've ever received?
Serve the song. When it comes to drumming, serve the song. Oh, don't overplay.
That's kind of deep. Okay, let's see. What's the last song that got stuck in your head?
I've heard so many recently.
Like an earworm.
An earworm? Oh, I can't even think of one, to be honest with you. I can't even think of one.
Well, you're so musically inclined, you're probably listening to full symphonies.
Yeah, actually, there was one, Tender Years by John Cafferty and the Beaver Brown Band, because I just recently
there's a band I haven't heard in a while.
Yeah, I just recently watched the movie Eddie and the Cruisers.
What a great movie, right?
Yeah, so that song, I've always liked that song.
Hey, so if you could jam with any musician or vocalist, living or deceased, who would you want to rock out with?
Oh, Neil Peart, of course. I'd want to drum along with him. If it had to be someone other than a drummer, Miles Davis.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Actually, I had the inkling you were going to say Steve Vai because we had mentioned him before, but yeah. Miles Davis. Oh, wow. Yeah. That's amazing.
Well, he was a character.
That goes back to your roots. Exactly. Yeah.
And you never knew what you were going to get with Miles Davis. Okay? I've heard people say he was a mean guy. Then I heard people say he was a funny guy. So, you know,
I guess it depends on the day of the week. I guess we can all be like that sometimes. Yeah. So if given, this is a tough one. If given the choice, would you rather be super happy and poor or miserable, but rich beyond your wildest dreams?
Super happy, but poor.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Good for you. Yeah. I agree. If you could only listen to three albums for the rest of your life, what three albums would that be?
Rush 2112. Kansas Left Overture, and the first Boston album.
Oh, okay. Okay. Yeah. That's the one with More Than a Feeling.
More Than a Feeling, yeah. Okay.
Actually, I know all three albums really well, so that's awesome. Last question, Android or iPhone?
Android.
And okay. One X. to each their own. Androids are great too. iPhones are great. So Kevin, dude, it's been a pleasure. And I'd like to thank you so much for giving BGX Radio your valuable free time to talk to us today.
Oh, it's been my pleasure. Thank you very much for your time to come and sit and listen to my babbling.
No, it's my pleasure. I mean, is there anything you wanted to say in closing, like something, pretty much anything? Yeah,
I just want people to know that go to my website and go to my YouTube channel, listen to my music, watch my videos, and if you have any questions or you want to reach out to me, don't be shy. I don't bite. Contact me. I'll gladly speak with you. I answer every email that I get, and if there's something you want to see me do on YouTube, like a particular song you want to see me do a play along cover to or something, shout out to me. Let me know.
Awesome. Kevin, once again, thank you so much. This has been amazing. Your time's invaluable. Your experience, I mean, I'm humbled by your experience and what you've done. So keep up the good work. Hopefully we can get some people, additional people out to some of the Rock of 80s shows and into your Facebook group and into some of your drumming programs and stuff like that. So,
And
so,
Likewise, you're doing great work here for helping to promote local talent and independent talent and keep on keeping on.
That's one of our goals. We got to stick by our indie community and our local entertainers.
Exactly.
Absolutely got to do that. So that's a wrap for another awesome episode of Niagara Live Sessions. I'm your host, Ken B. And I want all of our listeners to have an awesome week filled with great music and laughter. I will be posting all of the social media links for Kevin on the BGX Radio Facebook page and Twitter page once the show airs. And so we are now going to leave you with a little bit of Rush. From the 1977 album, A Farewell to Kings, this is Xanadu on BGX Radio.